Okay.
All right, 4:55, so we'll go ahead and get started. Thanks, everyone, for coming out to our talk today. It's really exciting to be doing in-person conferences again, so hope you all enjoy as well. I'm Travis Adair, CTO of Predibase. It's a company that spun out of Uber AI, focusing on providing a low-code and highly scalable machine learning platform, and I'm here with Nicholas.
I'm Nicholas. I'm a senior deep learning engineer at NVIDIA. I'm focusing more at deep learning training at scale.
And we both have been working on the Horovod project for a number of years now, and we're here to tell you a little bit about some of the applications of Horovod and how it's evolved and how the entire distributed training ecosystem has evolved over the years, and hopefully find a way to make it useful for you in the work that you're doing as well. So to quickly start off with a little background, so the problem that we're talking about here is that we want to train these deep neural networks that have some pre-processing step followed by a series of layers that provide what's called the forward pass, and then at the end you get a prediction, and then based on the error in that prediction, you then backpropagate all of the these gradients that you compute back to update the weights of the model. And this backpropagation step, these gradients, need to be aggregated in some way, oftentimes, in order to do this in a distributed setting, and that's going to be at the crux of the problem that we're going to talk about. So broadly, there are two ways to do this kind of distributed training thing. One of them is what we would call model parallelism, where you would subdivide different sections of the model across different hardware, or usually GPUs. And the other is what we call data parallelism, which is what we commonly happen when your model is fairly reasonably sized, but your data set is too large to fit into, to be handled by a single machine, right? And so both of these are commonly used in practice today, and we'll be talking a little bit about each of them. So going back in time to about 2016, there was really only one way to do distributed training, and it was called parameter servers. This was something that was developed by, or pioneered by Google in a big way with a paper called Disbelief, and they packaged it up into TensorFlow back in the early days when TensorFlow was pretty much the only game in town for doing deep learning. So at Uber, one of my colleagues, Alex Sergeyev there, was a tech lead for the deep learning infrastructure team working to support the self-driving car group. And the problem that they had was that they had these very large perception models that were processing, you know, terabytes, petabytes of image data, and they just couldn't train these models fast enough, right? And so Alex was looking at what was out there in the market, saw the parameter servers, we tried giving it to them, and it wasn't working for them. And specifically, it wasn't working because it required making very substantive changes to their actual training scripts in order to use it, required a deep understanding of the infrastructure itself and how it worked, and also significantly complicated the operationalization story, because not only did you have to think about the architecture for these training processes, you also had to think about the architecture for those parameter servers themselves. And so that led to the development of the Horovod framework itself, which has started as a data parallel framework for doing distributed training. We've developed it to be framework agnostic, so it supports TensorFlow, PyTorch, MXNet, has many high-performance features, including support for NVIDIA's Nickel library, MPI using RDMA, and a special technique that we call Tensor Fusion. It's very easy to use with just 5 lines of Python code, and of course, it's open source as part of the Linux Foundation, and very easy to install as well. And so at the heart of Horovod and where it gets its name from, which is a dance in Russian tradition, where you kind of like hold hands and dance in a circle, comes from this algorithm called AllReduce, which dates back to like the high-performance computing days. And the very interesting insight that was discovered by some folks at Baidu was that if you were to use this AllReduce algorithm to aggregate the gradients that you need to use to update the model, it actually ends up being the bandwidth optimal algorithm for doing this if that's the constraint that you have in your kind of computing environment. And so the way Horovod started out and the way it works in principle is that you just take these gradients across all your workers, pass them around in a certain way, and then at the end, they all have a single shared copy of the parameters that they use to update their models, and so none of them diverge as they train on different subsets of the data. And this approach turns out to be very fast. We benchmarked it on a number of different problems. The original ones we looked at were kind of in the computer vision domain, and so here you see benchmarks going up to 512 GPUs on a variety of benchmark architectures, but Nicholas will show you in a bit that this actually can scale quite a bit beyond that as well. And so today, when we look at a bit about the community and how this project has grown over the years, so starting from when we first open sourced it in 2017, it's since grown to be over 12,000 stars on GitHub. And we have quite a variety of different use cases as well, which is going to be at the heart of what we're going to talk about today. So we have a lot of people that are using it in research as well as production across academia. Some people using it as a hobby, which I congratulate those people. Community stats, we also have a variety of different sizes of workloads that people work with. Most people tend to kind of operate in, I guess, this 2 to 4 machine range, but you have some people that go up to, you know, very large clusters as well. Most people these days run it on Kubernetes, which is not a surprise. It's definitely very popular these days. Apache Spark and Ray are two other popular options for people who are in the kind of the ML ops world. But we also have a lot of people that run on HPC systems using schedulers like Slurm. And Databricks and Amazon SageMaker also have official integrations with Horovod as well. And I think one of the most interesting things for me personally is looking at this slide, which shows that we actually have a very good variety of people across both TensorFlow and PyTorch. You know, there's, as well as some people using TensorFlow V1, which in particular for people using TensorFlow V1, I think Horovod is really your only viable option. But definitely it's interesting to see the variety of people out there. And again, coming back to the diverging use cases, so while this project originally started out just purely focused on, you know, big data sets, computer vision models, trying to speed up training, there's really a lot of variety to what people are doing in the distributed training space today, and I think it's oftentimes difficult to cut through the noise and figure out, you know, when should I use Horovod versus another framework, and what are all these different features they're talking about. And so I think a few of the big ones that we want to talk about today will be the HPC case, which is where Horovod really like got its start and has done a lot of very interesting groundbreaking work, as well as a lot of the more interesting recent trends, which you may have been hearing a lot in the news recently about people claiming that machines have become sentient or something, and that's, you know, very much in this wheelhouse of very large language models. We also have a lot of people that are wanting to run not on, you know, dedicated HPC hardware, but more in the cloud, where the problem is a lot more about how do I reduce costs, how do I handle failover if I'm using preemptible instances. And then finally, there's MLOps, which I think is a very one, very near and dear to my heart and the business that I'm in. Which is very much about integration end-to-end with other data processing systems like Spark and Ray. And to start things off, I'll hand it over to Nicholas to talk about HPC.
Thank you, Travis. So the first use case that we look at is HPC, so high-performance computing. So you can see on the timeline, a lot of things happen, at least some breakthrough happen in the end of 2018, 2019. We'll focus on two, I guess, breakthrough, which is the Exascale paper that led to a lot of improvement in Horovod, and also the MLPerf competition that that also led to a lot of improvement in deep learning at scale. And I put back the star history to show that it matched up a little bit the when a lot of things happen at the beginning in deep learning at scale, which is the end of 2018, the star were going up, and after it starts smoothing out a little bit. So this publication, the Exascale paper, won the Gordon Bell Prize in 2018. It was really the first Exascale class deep learning application. Not with full precision, but FP16 precision, to be precise. And so it was the first time to do deep learning at this scale, so 27K GPUs. And we had a lot of improvement coming from that in the communication library, so with NVIDIA for Nicole, and also in the Horovod project. We'll talk about that in the next slide. We like to point out in the picture, in the middle, Josh Romero, who is a big contributor for Horovod. So one of the optimizations that came out from this publication is a response cache optimization. So the way Horovod works, it works in a really dynamic way in the sense that it will check on all the GPU which tensor are ready to be reduced, which gradient are ready to be reduced, and when some of them are ready, it will launch all reduce to perform the reduction and keep going. So we have kind of this loop in the code checking if there is any tensor to be ready. And before the optimization, the way to do it was to gather all the metadata of the tensors that were ready to GPU zero, so everybody sends their messages. And GPU zero was aggregating the data and sending back a list of the tensors that were ready to be reduced. And so the insight there is during deep learning training, the same tensors are always the same. So the solution was to implement a cache, so you don't have to do these exchange to a single point of failure GPU zero, and after send back the data to everybody. So so by just implementing a cache with one bit to represent each gradient tensor, when a tensor was ready on the GPU, you could flip it to one, and after really doing a all reduce on this bit vector to figure out which tensor was ready on all the GPU, you could after that send the all reduce communication. And so now a single collective operation with already small data to send over is just a bit vector. And you can see it on the graph that before the optimization, after 200, 400 GPUs, we're starting not scaling as well. But with the optimization, and which sends really a small amount of data, you can scale linearly at least to 800 GPUs. The other interesting thing I wanted to talk about in the HPC use case is the MLPerf training competition. So it's a benchmark at the same time as a competition. So it represents a diverse set of DL models to evaluate DL platforms, so both the software and the hardware of the platform. And the competition is organized twice a year, and people or competitors submit the results, but the results are peer reviews by the different competitors, so to keep the competition fair, and the results need to be, of course, reproducible. And over the years, so the competition, I think, started in 2017. Over the years, like a lot of insight came from this competition optimization, especially at scale. So in the last submission of MLPerf was in the fall, so fall 2021, we see that 4 out of the 8 benchmark records used Horovod for the scale-out submission. And you see it is different type of neural network, so Minigo for reinforcement learning, 3D UNet for image segmentation, SSD for object recognition, and ResNet 50 for image classification. And one of the improvements we made to Horovod for the last submission was the async data dependency optimization that we'll talk in the next slide. So we saw that for data parallelism, the goal of Horovod is to average those gradient tensors after each at the end of each iteration. And what we had in the code, I guess if you don't have the optimization enabled, is still doing that. The CPU will be waiting that the forward pass, the backward pass is done. And after that, Horovod will check that the tensors are ready on all the GPU, and then we'll be able to launch the GPU kernel to do the communication operation. And after that, the CPU will be waiting again for the output of the communication to tell the framework that you can do other things like sending optimizer work to the GPU. So what we did is we kind of lowered down those dependencies to GPU stream. So the framework and Horovod could queue up the GPU operation even if they were not finished on the GPU. So you can see on the after kind of diagram, we managed to queue up the forward pass, the backward pass, the all reduce, and even the optimizer before the backward pass is done. So you see there is no gap in GPU utilization between the backward pass and the all reduce and the all reduce and the optimizer. So you get faster training time and more GPU utilization. So a few tips to, especially to scale at big scale. So the first thing usually you want to do is to utilize properly your GPU is to use the maximum batch size that you can to utilize all the memory of your GPUs. But at one point, you will see that for large batch, the quality of your conversions will degrade. And so a lot of time you want to stop there. You want to maintain this good convergence curve. But at that point, you will switch to strong scaling. So instead of increasing the problem size, you will keep the same problem size, but you will add more resources to it. But the downside of that is the computation per GPU decreases, but the communication stays the same. So you cannot overlap as much of the communication behind the computation. So you need to be, you need to make sure that you don't have too many latency in your stack. And so the improvements that I mentioned earlier, the async data dependency really decrease the latency of Horovod, which is really good for strong scaling. Another tip also for strong scaling is to reduce the cycle time. So the frequency often Horovod is checking for work to do. But the downside of doing that, if you don't do anything else, is you may be sending over the network just small data, just one or two tensors instead of aggregating them. So to prevent that, you can enable the group all reduce where you can do static grouping. So you can tell Horovod, even if only one tensor is ready now, I want to make sure that I have a bucket of tensor before sending it over the network so that I don't pay the cost of just sending small messages. Another use case that became more popular, as Travis mentioned, is modal and hybrid parallelism. So a lot of work has been done inside Horovod to have that working. And since Horovod was doing mainly data parallelism, now you have the option, with Horovod being a generic framework, to be able to do also modal parallelism. So if you look at the timeline, in the community, you will see there's a lot of things happen also for modal parallelism around the beginning of 2019. We'll focus on two use cases. One is recommender systems, like DLRM. So think about recommender system models that predict like on which ads you are going to click, which movie you are going to like or watch. And the other use case is large NLP model, large language model. So we saw in 2019 the coming up of different specialized frameworks like DeepSpeed and Megatron LM that focus on that. So in the case of DLRM, so if we think about a model that predicts which movie you are going to like or watch, in those inputs that you need to represent, so they are represented in the embedding space, so the embedding layer, you need to represent the user demographics, the different movies. So the more movie you want to put in your model, the more user you want to put in the model, the bigger the embedding layer will be. So that become like a memory constraint aspect of your model. So the way to solve that is to split the embedding layer across multiple GPUs. And after that, when you pass this layer that is memory constrained, you can do data parallelism, like the normal way that Travis talked about, where every GPU have the same model, but they work on different input data. And to switch between model parallelism and data parallelism, we have a communication phase, which is an old tool where each GPU send pieces of their embedding layer to all the other GPUs. The other use case, which is large NLP models, you can see on, I wanted to put this graph to show that, yeah, over the years, those models become bigger and bigger, so they are able to do more language tasks in a more generic way and also to be more accurate. And so you go to billions of parameters, even now trillions of parameters. So the way to scale large model, the common way is to do 3D parallelism, where you split it in three ways. So the normal way is the data parallelism. We talk about that. And the two other ways, pipeline and model parallelism. So for model parallelism, is more you are splitting the layer horizontally. So intra-layer split. And for pipeline parallelism, you are partitioning the layers of your model into buckets, and you put them in different GPUs. So for data parallelism, the communication is all reduced. We talk about that. For tensor parallelism, we added the concept of process sets. So it's like grouping of GPUs. So now instead of GPU has to communicate with everybody, you can communicate in a subset. Let's say you were doing tensor parallelism inside just a server node. You can say your group is a node and you will just communicate with your neighbors inside the same node. And for pipeline parallelism, you can do point-to-point. And we have a way to do it with a group size of 2 with an all-to-all operation of Horovod. So I just wanted to show you how easy it is to use. So you will, of course, import Horovod, but you can use MPI for Pi to create a sub-communicator to tell Horovod that for model parallelism, for example, tensor parallelism, you only want to communicate inside your box. And for that, when you call the allReduce function, you will pass the process set argument with the process set you created with the MPI subcommunicator. So you will just communicate inside your box. And I wanted to include also the case of when you switch from model parallelism to data parallelism for the LRM, you just call to all on your local embedding tables. And now I will let Travis talk to you about the use case of the cloud.
Thanks, Nicholas. So I think a couple of the things that we just talked about are definitely on the very bleeding edge things that a lot of very wealthy tech companies have been pioneering. And I think that another use case, though, that a lot of people come with is, you know, they want to do distributed training because they have what you might call data sets of reasonable scale, as my friend Jacopo might say on these days. But basically, you still have the need for doing distributed training, but you're not quite at the scale of, like, you know, really, really big models, right? And I think that's where this idea of you want to run in the cloud, you want to reduce costs, you want to make it something that is as reasonable as possible, is where something like Elastic Horovod comes in. And the basic idea behind Elastic Horovod is that you want to be able to both accommodate failover that might happen in the case of a node going down. So for example, you use a spot instance, and that spot instance is reclaimed by the system. Or also a new instance becomes available, like you're running in a multi-tenant environment, and you want to optimize for high throughput. And so one of the workloads finishes, the GPU is kind of put back in the pool, you want to be able to use it for your job temporarily while that's while it's available to you. And so the purpose of Elastic Horovod is to very elegantly handle this handover where a node goes down, we remove it from the job, a node comes up, we add it to the job, and all of this happens seamlessly without interruption. And so the way that we achieve this is essentially by having this separate driver concept that sits on top, kind of like if you're familiar with Spark, there's the Spark driver. If you're familiar with Ray, there's a Ray head. So the way that Elastic Horovod works is that the driver coordinates the work of all the other nodes and kind of has a global awareness of who's responding, who's not responding. And so when a failure occurs, that gets detected, and the workers that have not entered a failed state communicate back to the driver node and say, hey, I'm ready to continue work, who's still available to do work? And then the driver is responsible for adding any nodes that might have been added to the system and made themselves available, removing nodes that are gone, and sort of recreating the topology of how the machines communicate. We also have the ability to support what we call a graceful worker removal. So this is in the event where your system, your kind of resource manager, is able to tell you when it's going to reclaim a node before it does so. And this has a very nice property that if you know in advance that a node is going to be removed, you can remove it at the time that it's going to cause the least amount of disruption to your process. So a good example here would be if you're doing training and you're in the middle of doing like a backward pass and updating the weights, that's not a really ideal time to have a failure because you kind of have to revert back to the previous batch, which isn't the end of the world, but it does cause a bit of like time to sort of like, reset the state and sort of resume and deserialize things that you might have cached temporarily. Whereas if you can remove a worker just at the right time at the end of a batch, there's no kind of intermediate state you have to track, and it's a lot more amenable to high throughput. So that's exactly what we do here, and this is facilitated by this notification system where we propagate notifications about worker removals to the worker nodes so they can handle them at the time that's most beneficial to them. And I think it's really interesting to point out that a lot of people have questions about how well this performs. Certainly, I think that if you're very interested in determinism, there's elasticity is maybe not the best property. But if you're just looking for good model results, I think we've demonstrated in a series of blog posts that we've done that definitely we see that you can get very good results with elasticity, and in some cases even better results due to a property of kind of smoothing out the variance that can happen from having very consistent batches from one epoch to the next. And the last thing I want to say on Elastic is that it's also very nicely integrated in the Kubernetes stack as part of Kubeflow and the MPI operator. So this was some great work done by folks at Tencent to add this into Kubeflow. And so if you're interested in using it in Kubernetes, it's very easy to get started with Elastic Horovod. And the last use case that we'd like to talk about today is the MLOps use case, which is how you would run a system like Horovod on top of your existing data infrastructure, whether that's Spark or Ray or other systems. And so to motivate this, let's talk a little bit about how you run ML on your laptop. So this is kind of the setup for something I'm going to be talking about a few slides later, which is another project I work on called Ludwig. And the idea is that oftentimes when you're doing end-to-end machine learning, you don't just want to do training, but you also want to process the data in some way, do feature transformation or sanitize the data or what have you. And then you also need to do some evaluation on the model before finally putting that in a registry or a model store. And so, all these steps need to be thought about in scale, not just the training part in isolation, right? And so this is in contrast to something like how you would do an ML pipeline in production. So this is a slide that comes from the Michelangelo platform that I used to work on at Uber. And the basic idea behind ML in production is that you want to take all these same components, but you're going to be doing them at very large scale. So you might have something like a feature store in place of just the normal processing step. You might do batch training, and then your model store then goes out to like a real-time prediction service, or maybe like a data lake for doing batch prediction. And this is where something like Horovod on Spark comes in. So this was one of our earliest MLOps integrations. And the way that Horovod on Spark basically works is that it runs the Horovod software on top of the existing Spark executors, but outside of the Spark graph execution itself. And so the way that we achieve this is that we actually use an intermediate layer, which is some kind of object storage like HDFS or S3, where we write out the data that comes from the feature processing or data processing to Parquet format, and then consume that data by the training workers for training. And then evaluation can then use the normal RDD representation that Spark provides. And so here's kind of a little bit zoomed in to what that process looks like. So we have a framework that was ran at Uber called Pedastorm that is commonly used to do the actual data loading from the Parquet file into the workers, and then each worker maintains its own local shuffle buffer that then actually does the batching and sending of data to the workers for training. And let's talk a little bit about real-world example of this. So Ludwig is, like I said, another framework I work on as part of the Linux Foundation as well, a low-code deep learning framework that supports multitask learning. And the high idea behind what we wanted to do with Ludwig was exactly this idea of scaling it up to support both the feature processing and the training parts simultaneously. But when we were looking at how we might actually operationalize this, particularly for a project that's open source where people are kind of running it, in all sorts of different environments, this was the challenge that was in front of us, is we were worried we were going to have to build a system like this, which is a system pattern that we built a lot at Uber while I was there, which is you have a separate component that handles the data processing, a separate component that has training, a separate component that handles eval. And these are often different systems, usually Spark for data processing, training might be Horovod. And then you have to orchestrate it all together using some kind of workflow orchestration system like Apache Airflow. And so we didn't want to necessarily force this on users in the open source, and definitely we wanted to make our lives operationally easier as well. And so that's where we came up with this Ray integration for Horovod, which is now a standard part of the Ludwig framework. And the beautiful thing about Ray, in my opinion, is that it allows you to combine all of these disparate heterogeneous steps into a unified layer. And so the pre-processing, training, evaluation, all of that happens within a single Ray cluster, a single abstraction layer. And the handoff between these different steps is similarly handled kind of transparently to you by Ray itself. So if you haven't checked out Ray, I highly recommend it. It's a really powerful tool for allowing you to get up and running with something like Horovod as part of as being one component with a larger pipeline. And this also extends beyond training to hyperparameter optimization as well. So another feature we have in Ludwig is that you can run the same kind of distributed training process for pre-processing, training, evaluation, et cetera, and then also fan this out into multiple trials that are all coordinated by a hyperparameter search scheduler. And so that kind of modularity is also one thing that makes Horovod on Ray particularly interesting. And that's it. Thank you very much for coming today. Nicholas, would you like to say any final words here?
Oh, sure. So yeah, we saw that, we had multiple use cases for deep learning. And we saw also that for different use cases like large model, like specialized framework came into being, like Megatron, DeepSpeed, specializing in large model. But Horovod tried to stay generic. So that's why you can do data parallelism, you can do model parallelism, and you can support a rich kind of environment, a rich DL ecosystem. And so yeah, we are happy to welcome you into the community if you want to help us to keep improving the product. I think you have a link to the Slack.
Yes, I think on the next slide.
Okay. Yeah. So if you want to join our Slack, I think to join our Slack, there is kind of a poll at the beginning that help us to see what your interests are, in which environment you are using DL and on which platform you are using it. So kind of the stats you show now.
Yeah.
Do you have any question?
I know we packed a lot into a relatively short amount of time, so definitely I'm not surprised if there aren't too many immediate questions, but definitely happy to take any questions later, or please feel free to reach out to us on GitHub or LinkedIn or Twitter. Yeah, that's a good question. So, Nicholas, you could probably maybe give a little bit more flavor, but the kind of heuristic that we typically go with in the past is that, if you have 100 gigabit, that's like usually considered to be like, very good, you're in a good spot. You can go lower in some cases if you're wanting to use things like FP16 compression, or potentially if you have weaker GPUs, older SKUs like T4s or like some lower powered ones like T4s, potentially P100s, things like that. But for V100s with full 32-bit precision, like 100 gigabit is usually what we recommend.
Yeah, I would say the same thing. But like nobody prevents you to try it on a smaller like a network, a normal like Ethernet network, like 10 gig if you want. But yeah, it will perform better on a 100 gig Ethernet or RDMA or InfiniBand.
Yeah, I will say that, definitely if you have like a small worker size, like just a couple nodes or something like that, weaker networks can generally get away with it. And then another thing that oftentimes people do when they have like, really bandwidth constrained environments like 10 gigabit is they'll use what's called local gradient aggregation, where you can, instead of doing the backward pass every step, you kind of save the weight, the gradients, and then you kind of do another forward pass and like aggregate those inside a single worker, and then do an aggregation across the workers like after 10 steps or something like that, right?
Yeah, so you will increase your global batch size before like doing the optimizer steps.
Awesome. Good question. All right.
Thank you for coming.
Well, thank you very much.